There's a lot of hype around PJ Harvey's appearance on Jules tomorrow night. It's all here from 10, but now on BBC Two Wales with some strong language and adult humour. The Easter weekend is still going.
She acts, just not on this show. It's the wonderful Ruth Jones!
So nice to be here. Do you like my set? I'm going for the... Thank you. Going for the Easter theme. Do you like the eggs?
Yes!
Should have seen the chicken that laid them. I am so excited about tonight's show. I've got some fantastic guests. A personal heroine of mine, the incomparable Dawn French. My old friend from Youth Theatre, who's now a massive Hollywood star, Michael Sheen. And ever so musical and ever so funny, Tim Minchin. Plus, we have the voice of 2011, Claire Maguire is here. But first of all, let's say hello to my house band.
Hello.
And to my very own Easter Bunny girls, the Rockabellas. Hi, girls. My first guest has been making audiences laugh for over 30 years. She's a personal inspiration of mine, and I'm so honoured to have her here tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the fabulous Dawn French.
Very much. Oh, what a fantastic set.
I know.
Fantastic girls, fantastic band.
I know. We've got chocolate eggs, we've got the rabbits.
Oh, shame I hate chocolate.
Oh, that is
made of chocolate.
Do you do the whole Easter thing then? Do you like the whole Easter?
I'm not very good at it actually because I do forget that it's Easter. I think it's easier when your kid is younger and you get Easter holiday.
Yeah.
When they're older and they don't have Easter holiday, you completely forget. That's very ungodly of me, I know, that's not right.
You've actually been an Easter Bunny a couple of times.
I certainly have.
Because the first time I ever saw you on telly, you were playing an Easter Bunny in The Young Ones.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Yes, that's right, I did.
Look, there you are.
Oh, happy days. Oh,
and it was the middle of June or something, you got sent away, didn't you?
Yes, that's right. Sad. That's right, yeah.
Oh, that's you made a nice Easter Bunny.
And I was an Easter Bunny, I think, in The Vicar of Dibley also. I was.
Have we got a picture of that?
Yes.
You've gone white.
Although,
now.
Many, many different colours as far as the bunny outfits are concerned. And in fact, my daughter came to the set of this and had her own bunny outfit on. And at that point, actually, Len had a bunny outfit on as well, so we're an entire bunny family. Yeah.
Now, I have to talk to you about your latest venture, because we all know and love you as a comedian and an actress.
Oh, thanks. Do we all know and love me?
We all, I think.
Oh, good.
Okay.
Okay. There. No. I just thought there might just be one or two who didn't. Just wanted to identify them.
And if they were there, we would send them out.
Yes.
No, but recently, you've already written your autobiography, Dear Fatty, a couple of years ago. And then now you've ventured into novels.
I have.
And Dawn has written this wonderful book called A Tiny Bit Marvellous, which is a lot big marvellous. It's out in paperback on the 23rd of June. It's brilliant. It's so funny.
Oh,
it's...
thanks, Ruth.
But I thought I'd read that you were a bit of a technophobe. So how do you do it?
Pencil, lined paper.
No.
Yeah,
really?
Which I think you'll find quite a lot of people wrote books like that for quite a long time. I haven't actually gone as far as a chisel. Yeah, but no, I don't own a computer, and I've actually, I think I have touched one now. Jennifer made me touch one once, but I'm just not a fan. I've never gone there.
A Tiny Bit Marvelous is about, how do you describe it? A slightly dysfunctional family.
Yes, although. Having lived in my own family, I don't think they are that dysfunctional, no. Actually. And watching other families, I don't think they are.
Yeah,
I
mean, they're a normal family.
They are a normal family. Yeah. Like they've got some. There are some eccentrics in the family, but I think that makes a normal family, personally.
And you really seem to capture the teen speak really, really well. Why is that? Do you know a lot of teenagers?
I have got a teenager, although I have to point out that Dora is not my teenager.
No.
But she's an amalgam of a lot of girls I've met through my daughter. And it's just hilarious. Conversation all the time.
Yeah.
But if I interrupt at all, I am just a cretin.
Right.
My daughter's friends quite like me, and that annoys my daughter because that completely ruins her whole relationship where I am just an idiot.
Yeah.
And everything is answered to me, not just by her, but, you know, that by a character like this in single words where you say, you know, how was school? Yeah, fine. What did you do? Learning. And it said, like, not learning, you idiot. You idiot is what is just, yeah. You know, inferred in every sentence. So you feel like an idiot, actually.
Yeah. When I read it, I did cry and laugh when I read it, because there are some moments in there, which the sort of the teen angst, you know, that I've certainly been through, probably most people have been through, yeah. Especially, I think, as girls.
Yeah.
And reading the book made me look at my own teenage diaries, because I just thought, oh, gosh, you know, it'd be interesting to know how I spoke back then. And some of the language that I used, I'd completely forgotten about. Like, there were expressions that, for example, and now I was a teenager, so we're talking early 80s, right? If something was brilliant, yeah. We used to say it was chock.
Chock?
Chock. Oh, it's chock, that is. Oh, it's chock. Oh, yeah, oh, it's really chock.
Had
oh,
you forgotten about that,
yeah,
then, until you
forgotten.
Looked at it?
But we asked our lovely audience if they would send in some of their diaries.
Oh, OK.
And they obliged. A couple of people were mad enough to do it. So where is Anna? Do we have hello Anna?
Hello.
Oh, Anna, you had a little bit of a celebrity crush, didn't you, when
I
you
did.
Were 14?
Still
like to
do.
Tell us who it was.
David Duchovny from The X-Files.
David Duchovny.
Yeah.
Because I think it always starts off, doesn't it, as a celebrity. Did you have a celebrity crush?
Yeah, I did. Well, David Essex was one for quite
was
a long time.
Yeah.
And Steve McQueen.
Oh, yeah.
Had a lot of posters
of
him.
Yeah. I liked Paul Michael Glaser. When the Starsky and Hutch.
Oh, you had no taste?
No. So you were obsessed with David Duchovny, and we've got some extracts here somewhere. January the 6th, it's 9:30 p.m. Oh, where are you from, Anna?
Barry.
All right, we go down Barry then. All right. All right, so, so January the 6th. I'm not being funny, it's 9:30 p.m. and I'm watching The X-Files. I loved David Duchovny. January the 9th, today I went downtown with Rachel and I got clear mascara. I also got my second David Duchovny calendar today.
Second?
Second, when she was a proper, proper fan. But moving on to the spring, you met a real David. Do you want to have a little read of these?
Well, I can't do it in a Barry accent, sorry.
Oh, I'm probably insulting her anyway because she doesn't talk
are
like
you?
That.
Okay. I've just had the most amazing weekend. On Thursday, I went to church and David and Jonathan were there. Not David Duchovny. David is so lush. We were talking and the eye contact is wicked. Then, on Friday, we were laughing and joking and the eye contact was amazing.
You know what? It's because she's got that clear mascara.
She had the eye contact.
But you know, by the summer, it got a little bit steamy, right?
Oh.
Yeah, because June the 27th, today we met the boys on the beach and I got a little drunk. I went with this boy called Jose. Oh, yes, that traditional Barry name.
Jose. Exciting.
We lay on the beach and we did a lot of kissing. Then July the 17th. Helen's wedding. I looked great and so did everyone else. Me and the best man hit it off and then I go with this lush usher. Who did did you actually end up with? Did you end up with Jose? Did you end up with a lush usher or David Duchovny?
David Duchovny.
Of course. Really? We're moving on now to Michelle. Where's Michelle? Michelle's got a 5-year diary.
Oh.
Yeah. Very posh, right? But she was a very angry person. A lot of anger going on there. Dawn, would you like to have a little read of these? Because, a little bit scary. A few little issues going on there for Michelle.
Okay. February the 18th, guess what? It's my birthday. Kimberly gave me a card and present, not... She didn't give me 1p even. Anyway, I went down the rugby club tonight. It was brilliant. I was piddled. I had 1 pint of lager, 3 bottles of Holston pills, and 2 vodka and oranges, and I am only 14. June the 19th, oh dear. Everybody's picking on me today, but the next person who cheeks me, I will fucking... Sorry about the language. No, don't be upset because she has put brackets, sorry about the language, to herself. I will fucking sorry about the language, slap them. June the 25th. I hate Tina fucking Carpenter. Emma Pissin Hopkins.
Thank you very much to our brilliant diarist. You've been amazing. Very brave. Now, I saw one of your last French and Saunders shows live.
Yes.
And I can't believe... Have you really retired from it, you and
I
Jennifer?
I think we have from doing sketches. Mm. I think there's a sort of time that doing sketches is OK and then it feels kind of like a bit like you've done it. And we always said that we would only work together and do sketches together as long as it made us laugh. Mm. And the minute you stop laughing, you can't ask an audience to laugh if you're not quite enjoying it yourself. But there are many other things that we would like to do together. So we were talking just this morning, actually, about all various things that we want to do. We're doing a bit of radio together. We might write a movie together. Actually, you know, the point about Jennifer and I is that we started as friends. Mm. And then we... Well, you know this stuff. You drift into working together and it's a great partnership. But actually, the friendship is what matters more.
Yeah,
so whether
absolutely.
We're doing it on the telly or just doing it in our front room to amuse ourselves doesn't really bother me either
way. Do you think, though, that the friendship is the secret of your success as a double act?
I do. Because we love each other. I genuinely, profoundly love that woman.
Aww.
And she also is the person who makes me laugh the most in the world.
Is she?
I would say. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
We do all love French and Saunders, though, don't we? And we miss you. We miss you. More recently, you've been in a series which I absolutely love. Roger and Val have just got in.
Oh, I'm glad you love that.
Oh, I love it. It's brilliant.
I mean, these writers, I have to give big props to these writers. They're twin sisters, Emma and Beth Kilcoyne, and they find a way to write the very tiny things of life, but inside it say something very, very big and very profound.
Yeah.
And that's what I love about that show, you know, which was just about two people who get home from work, and it's the first half an hour when they get in. They tell each other about their day. They love each other very much, but slowly as the series goes on and it unpeels, you realise that they're really distracting each other from a very big thing that happened.
It's different from what you've done before in the sense that it's observational, it's kind of gentler.
It is.
Do you think your own taste in comedy changes as you get older?
Yes, I do. Funny you should say that. I was just thinking about that the other day. I think it definitely does, and I think that might be the clue as to why Jen and I stopped doing the sketches, which felt just a bit too broad for us at the moment.
Yeah.
Not that I never want to stop showing my bum.
Yeah.
You know, I'll always want to be a bit silly. Yeah. But sometimes you want to do something that means something to you or that moves you or, you know, touches you or opens your heart up a bit. Yeah. And I think that might be to do with getting a bit older. Yeah, I think it might be.
But you never know. You and Jen, you might be in a residential home for the elderly.
Yes.
In years to come and you can entertain each other.
Very possibly. Very possibly.
Now, one thing thing that I must ask you about. You're dating again now? Is that sort of?
Well, I'm quiet about it, really,
okay,
because I sort of feel like this is a very vulnerable time.
Right.
And I've got people's feelings to consider,
sure,
my kid, and not least my, as I like to call him, first husband.
You're righty-ho.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I don't like to rub anybody's nose in it,
no,
so I keep it all a bit quiet.
But would you say, though, that you are partial to a snog?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think, because in your book, you've got a list, in Dear Fatty,
yes,
there's a list of Dawn's conquests in the snog department.
Yes.
Would that be a fair way,
yes,
of putting it?
That is true.
You've done George Clooney, Brad Pitt, Johnny Depp.
Can you believe,
you know,
it?
Amazing.
I can't believe it.
We have come up with a special game just for you, just as a tribute to your love.
Is it Kiss Everyone game in the Audience?
Yes, it is.
I love that game!
It's called French Kiss or Give It a Miss. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you some pictures of some lips.
Yes.
I'm not going to show you who they belong to initially. And then I just want you to say, based on the lips, whether you would French kiss or give them a miss. So,
okay.
So we'll start off. Here's our first set of lips. What do you think?
Ooh, no, give a miss.
Oh, that was the very instant response.
It was.
Give a miss. Okay, let's see who they belong to.
Looks like... yeah.
David Dickinson.
I was right.
You were probably right.
I was right.
So I'm sure that Mrs. David Dickinson likes kissing them.
Yes.
If there is one.
I think you might catch woodworm.
Well, moving swiftly on to the second lips now.
Yes, definitely,
yeah,
and I know who that,
yeah,
is.
See,
I've
you've
already
been there.
I've been there.
Because they belong to Johnny
Depp.
Oh, now then, let's have a look at this next set. It's quite a mystery.
I feel like
that
I
one
know who that is. Prince Charles.
Let's have a look. What do you think? Would you or
well,
would you?
Well, I have to say, I did used to have a little crush on Prince Charles.
Did you?
Yeah. When I fantasised a bit about him, I'm letting you in to a bit of a...
Okay.
This might be a place you don't want to visit, to be honest.
No,
but I thought I'd like a little Sunday tumble with him, that sort of thing.
What is a Sunday tumble?
I wouldn't want him to speak. I'd like him to do what I say and shut up.
Really?
Yeah.
Only on
yeah
a Sunday? Only
yeah,
on a
Sunday morning.
Right, OK.
Yeah.
A Sunday tumble.
Yeah.
We've got
no
one last one for you now. This is going to be... I'm going to show you two sets and
yes
you have to pick one or the other, OK?
OK.
Right.
Oh, mm, quite hard, isn't... That's a girl on the left.
Mm-hmm.
Not that I'm averse.
No.
But, I think I would have to go with the boy, actually.
OK.
I hope that is a boy.
Well, you might be about to get your chance because those lips on the right belong
yes
to...
yes!
Michael Sheen! But you did turn me down.
Oh, look!
See?
I did not know that was your mouth.
Did you?
I did not know
I
that
did,
was
because
you, and
there's
I've
a
been
bit
looking
of,
at you.
There's a bit of staining on the bottom
oh,
tusk.
Okay. Get it sorted, Ruth.
Dawn French, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. Now, you have just been looking at the lips of my next guest. He is one of the finest actors of his generation. He starred in films such as The Queen, Frost Nixon and The Twilight Saga. He's one of Wales's greatest exports and it's an absolute privilege to have him here tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, it's Michael Sheen! Your lips over mine.
Did
just
she?
Saying,
yes, I chose
yes
you.
She
every
did
time.
Yeah.
Are you happy Easter to you?
Thank you very much.
Are you a big Eastery person or not?
I'm going to be a very big Eastery person this Easter. Yeah. when people say what you're doing for Easter, I say, well, I'm going to be crucified, and I really am.
Yeah.
Because I'm doing a production that I've been working on for 2 years in,
yes,
in my hometown in Port Talbot called The Passion of Port Talbot.
You're doing things like you're staying awake for 3 days, you're sleeping in a prison cell, is that true?
Yeah, it's a contemporary story. It's not
right
set, you know, back in Jerusalem 2,000 years ago. It's set now, today, in Port Talbot. And it's a story, it lasts for 3 days. One performance that lasts for 3 days, 72 hours, non-stop.
Sounds like Ken Dodd.
I will be looking very like Ken Dodd. If my hair grows any bigger, I will look exactly like Ken Dodd. It takes place all over the town, because I'm asking people to tell me stories about the town, you know, all these amazing stories that you hear. And one of my favourite stories was last night, where I was talking to them, and I was saying, oh, down by the sand dunes, down by the beach, is my favourite place in Potomac. I really love it. And one woman went, yes, number 9 Tomp. And they all went, oh, number 9 Tomp, oh, lovely, lovely. Turns out number 9 Tomp was the name of a particular sand dune that courting couples would go to, and they would hide themselves in the nooks and crannies of number 9 Tomp, and then they would just shag like bunnies. And one woman there was going, oh, yes, my first child was a number 9 Tomp baby. I said, will you take me down there now so I can have a look? Oh, yes, yes, yes. It was fantastic. Oh, number 9 Tomp.
Would you have to count the Tomps? Not number 1 Tomp. Number 2 Tomp.
It's amazing because you're so down to it. You're still... Because Michael and I knew each other from youth theatre, you see. We were in National Youth Theatre of Wales together many
Ruth Jones
years
was
ago.
The femme fatale
was
of
that?
National Youth Theatre of Wales.
I didn't know
oh,
that.
Yes.
Oh, we heard she was the bike.
That's me there, Dawn. In the middle. I'm looking quite grumpy.
Look at that. Yeah, she's going, how come he's at the front?
Oh, yes. They were happy days. They were basically just an excuse, though, to get away from home and kiss boys, for me.
Yes. One man's femme fatale is another man's bike.
You were
a very desired person, very
well,
much so.
Why didn't you get anyone tell me that at the time? Honestly. So now that you're living in LA, I mean, it is a far cry from Potolbert. Potolbert,
yeah,
I
live saying. It's nothing like as glamorous as Potolbert, no.
But you're living in this LA lifestyle, but how much of it do you embrace? Like, are you on a macrobiotic diet or anything?
What you see, nothing that you see is real. It is all completely silicon. I had an exact replica of myself done in plastic surgery.
I get your money back, mate.
Yeah. So true, if only.
Do you think that, I mean, there does seem to be, everybody in LA seems to have surgery. What do you...
Well, but the weird thing is that when I first went around LA, I used to think that everyone was sort of related. Because a lot of the women looked the same. And
yes,
I thought it was...
Yes.
They all got the same plastic surgery. Because people literally walk around with the same noses, the same sort of puckered mouths, the same eyes. And it's like this weird family.
I've also heard now, though, that actors, because especially women, I suppose a lot of men as well, are having so much work done, that casting directors are actually finding it difficult to find women in their 70s who are actors who don't look like they're trying to look like they're 50. Yes. Do you know what I mean? And so it's actually going to become a bit of a problem.
Poor Talbot's time has come. Because we all look like we're 70 in Potolbert.
Even when you're 23.
Yes.
Now, is it true that your daughter hangs out with the Beckhams kids?
She has been known on occasion, yes.
Right.
Yes. She was ice skating once, and I was doing a film called Underworld at the time, one of the Underworld films. So I had sort of quite long, I had extensions in, long hair, beard, and I looked quite goth. And I went to pick Lily up, and Victoria was there. And it turned out later that she got very worried because she couldn't understand why a tramp was coming to pick up Lily. And then Lily's mum explained, no, this is, her father. And he's that actor, he's in The Queen. And then she went, I thought he was gay. So, as far as Victoria Beckham is concerned, I am a gay tramp. Which, is probably pretty good. I'm quite happy with that.
Take it when you
gay tramp.
You must have a great deal of street cred there with your daughter because you're in the Twilight saga.
That is correct, yes, yes.
Huge points for that.
Oh, yeah.
Are you a fan?
I don't really know it very well, but my daughter is an R. Patz freak.
Ah, right. Okay.
An R. Patz?
Yes.
Yeah, Robert Pattinson.
Oh, R. Patz.
R. Patz. You don't just say Robert Pattinson. You don't ever say that.
Really? I'm glad you told me that.
Oh, you are so uncool.
I really am. Look, there he is.
Look at that.
That's you as Arrow.
That's not R. Patz. That's me, yeah.
I must say that it's not something I would watch, the Twilight Saga.
No.
And then I thought, no, I'm going to watch it now because you were coming on the show. And I blooming loved it because it's all kind of like, will they, won't they? They're all about to kiss. It's all this kind of teenage sexual tension, and then they nearly kiss, and then they don't. And you kind of go, oh, for goodness sake, get on with it, you know, by the end.
Bite her, bite her!
Yeah, you do, you want to inflict biting upon the necks of these teenagers.
Well, that's always what it was. All the vampire things were all necks and biting.
Oh,
and
this completely
it's all teenage angst and Emma pissing Hopkins. Yeah, it's exactly the same. Exactly the same.
That's exactly right.
Now, you've played a lot of real-life people. Brian Clough, Tony Blair, three times. And Kenneth Williams, of course. Mm. What do you think it is about you as an actor that people kind of go to you for to play these real people?
Bland. I'm not joking. I think I'm bland.
No.
I have a face that somehow is able to kind of just become different things, I guess.
Well, that could be called acting.
I suppose.
Maybe it could be that.
Yes, exactly.
I think you're a brilliant actor.
He is.
But I just don't understand why you've come out of Two and a Half Men.
Well, it was because of the whole, you know, my drug taking and my, you know, my many
What's your problem,
affairs with prostitutes.
Ego.
It is, it's terrible.
You have done a stint on 30 Rock, though, actually.
I did, yeah, I did.
Oh,
I,
did you?
Yeah, it's very, I've never really done anything that is sort of out and out comedy. And so I take my hats off to both of you in that it's such a difficult thing. The stuff I do, if you do a gag and no one laughs, it's fine because it's drama. It's just character.
Right.
It's character. It's fine they don't laugh.
Yeah.
If you're doing something that is out and out comedy and no one laughs, you've just failed.
Do you think, though, that comedians are more competitive than actors? Do you know what I mean? Do you think
When I was at drama school, in my second year at drama school, I got to audition for Whose Line Is It Anyway, with all these stand-up comedians. It was the most competitive group of people I'd ever been in my life.
Yeah.
When there were little breaks and we'd sort of stand around, anything you said, people would be like, and then they'd try and top it and get another funny thing in, another funny thing.
Yeah.
And I thought actors were competitive, but comedians.
Do you think that's true, Dawn?
Yeah, I think it is competitive, but I think there's a neediness. I think it's rather, it's a disease, actually. A great disease, entertaining for other people. But I think that, I mean, I cannot go on any of those kind of panel shows. I can't do it because I can't enter that arena in that way. I find it
I think, though, that's a lot as well. I've done a couple of them, and I think women, I think we're a bit more polite about interrupting.
Yeah.
You know, and think that the men on there just kind of, like, keep going for it, you know.
Yeah.
But it's certainly very different. Now, you're obviously really busy at the moment with the Passion Play, and I have to say that when this goes out, Michael will have already done the Passion Play, but you are making it into a film and a TV documentary.
There's a documentary about the process, so about, you know, working with the community and everything that involved. Then a documentary about the actual 3-day event.
Yeah.
And then there's a film of the piece as well.
Now, I did hear a rumour, tell me if this is true or not, that you are going to be playing the next Blofeld in the James Bond movie. Is that true?
That is absolutely not true.
Ah.
No.
I'd
love to be a Bond villain.
Would you? Because I think you'd make a good Blofeld, because he does a good villain, don't you think?
Absolutely.
You know, he's got the sort
sinister.
Of the mean...
Because I'm shifty.
Yeah.
And bland.
And you... Sly.
I could be James Bland. That's what I could be.
Well,
Licensed not to throw.
I was just wondering if you would indulge me and just show me what your Blofeld might be like. I've got some props over there. I've got a nice chair, and there's a couple of little props there that might help.
Okay.
And I just wondered if we put you in the mood, if you could, like, do the famous line, and let's just see what you would be like if you
were. What
it
would have been like. Okay.
Yes. Ladies and gentlemen, Michael Sheen as Blofeld. Now, I'm going to play you some music, and when the music finishes, you can turn in your own time and deliver the famous line.
I've been expecting you, Mr. Bond.
That I think you've got something there, but I was just wondering, sort of in the spirit of inclusivity, and seeing as we are in Wales, would you try him again, and this time maybe put a bit more of a Talbot slant?
Okay.
Just to see how that comes out.
Okay.
Okay, so we'll have some more music again. the very best of luck with The Passion and with all your future projects. It's been lovely to talk to you. Ladies and gentlemen, Michael Sheen. Now, I'm a huge fan of my next guest. He's a musical comedy genius, but a lot of his songs are quite long and a tinsy bit rude. So, just for me, I've asked if he wouldn't mind singing a 3-minute, very clean song. He is hoping. Please welcome the brilliant Tim Minchin.
Clock. My people rang me up a couple of weeks ago. Yeah, I've got people and a phone and a grasp on the passage of time. Yeah, they rang me up, said, Tim, will you go on Ruth Jones' show? They want you to sing a song. It'll be fine, fine, fine. But the problem with my particular oeuvre is that half my songs are 5 minutes and over. And the wisdom here at the BBC is that viewers switch off if you go past three. And a lot of my songs have a bit of bad language, which causes the viewers untold anguish. It seems their tolerance for smuttiness is reserved for pussy puns on Are You Being Served? And so I need a song that only goes for 3 minutes without no bums or blasphemy in it. A lovely little song specifically written for the delicate skin of middle-class Britain. I need a song with a chorus and a verse with no nasty-ass cussing and a cussing. I'm a little too lewd and a little too long. I gotta find myself a 3-minute song. And they said, remember, boy, that music is light lovemaking. It's simply self-indulgent to take it past 3 minutes. Remember, boy, that music is light lovemaking. Everybody loves a penis, but length must have a limit. So you need a song that only goes for 3 minutes without no pornography or politics in it. You're a little verbose and a little bit wrong. You gotta find yourself a clean living 3-minute song. 300 beats at 100 beats a minute with nice clean jokes and a hoedown in it. Something for the telly that never ever fails to appease the viewers of BBC Wales. And even in the bridge, I won't be lyrically adventurous, intellectually unmentionous, or racially contentious, and I won't make double entendres at the expense of the Chinese. For China is a country that can bring me to my knees. For China, for China, for China, for China, for China is a country that will bring us to our knees. Ooh, Mr. Humphreys, my pussy is all wet. Two, three, foreskin. I need a little happy, clappy country song. Nice and repetitive and not too long. Boring enough, but not too boring, with a key change here to prevent me snoring. I need a song that is only 3 minutes without no buggery or blasphemy in it. Something with a pleasing rhyme and rhythm. Well, if you can't beat them, get conservative with them. To flog more tickets to my concerts by convincing the viewer that musical satire hasn't progressed since Victor Borga. You've got a telly and I wanna be in it, and apparently you'll only watch for 3 minutes. Yeah, apparently you'll only watch for 3 minutes.
That was just fantastic. Absolutely amazing.
Good. Oh, good. It's some words.
I'm just so honoured that you wrote that for the show. Because you were up against it, weren't you, having to cut down your long songs.
It's not an uncommon problem for me. I do want to perform on television, but I either write really long songs or really rude songs or really long rude songs.
Yeah.
Or really short rude songs, but never short not rude songs.
Yeah, except tonight.
Well, except tonight, yeah. Oh, I did it.
And I really appreciate it because you're so busy at the moment. You're on tour. You've just been to Australia touring?
Yeah, I just did my big stupid orchestra thing.
Do you take the same orchestra with you everywhere?
Yeah, in the UK I do. In Australia I was picking up the state symphony orchestras, which was interesting because they're you know, they're the State Symphony Orchestra, and they come in with their charts and they unpack their fiddles. They're perfectly polite, but just professional, head down, sort of, what's this about? And they sort of, and then by the second rehearsal there, you know, and by the second or third show, they're swearing, and it's really, I have to seduce the orchestra each time. Whereas over here, I don't have to seduce them because I pay them.
Did you?
Just like women. Men. Whatever you fancy.
Did they? Is it true that they took on your image a little bit, though?
Well, that was the thing with the Sydney Symphony, because they were the kind of most upstanding. They're based at the Sydney Opera House. You know, they are the orchestra in Australia with the most respect. And I came on stage and they hadn't told me, but all the violinists in the front row had teased their hair up.
Oh, fantastic.
And it's just like, oh my God, they've teased their
quite
hair
touching.
For me. So I don't do that. That's the first time I've ever done that. So.
But your image is quite sort of trademark, because in the early days you looked quite different. I think we've got a picture of you, actually.
Oh, really? Thanks.
Yeah. you look a bit like Paul McCartney.
Oh, thanks. I've got a lot in common with Paul. I marry the wrong women and I'm a genius. Yeah.
Where did you get from that to this then? What was the journey of
actually, that is a little club in South Melbourne called the Butterfly Club, and if you jam them in, you can fit 40 people in the room, and you're not allowed amplification or anything. And that's where I sort of started doing these cabaret shows, really, that turned into what I do now. And even there, I reckon I was probably wearing a little bit of mascara and stuff, because I come from a theatre background, sort of, and you know that, and especially when your hands are trapped, I always was aware that people, if they can't see what's going on here, not even in that song there where I'm desperately reading the auto cue, I'm still, you know, all my communication's coming out of my eyes, so it really started like that, and then I grew my hair a bit and then got it chemically straightened, and I suddenly realised that if
I... Did
you say
you got it chemically,
chemically straightened, yes.
What does that mean?
Well, it's like, it's a perm, but it's...
The opposite.
Yeah, the opposite of Michael's perm.
Because you're a very curly person.
I haven't done it for months.
Of course.
Because I hate wearing wigs, so I get my hair straightened when I
And it's great, huh?
Boys know more about hair than us.
Yeah, you should hear me. I can hold court on vaginas as well.
Can I just tell you, by the way, if you go up the valleys...
I beg your pardon?
If you go up the valleys, the South Wales valleys...
Sorry, here we go.
Have you never been taken up the valleys?
I haven't. I've always been curious, though.
Because if you want to go there, Ruth is your girl.
Really?
Yeah.
You're the one, apparently. My first experience of being taken up the valleys.
No, if you want to go up the valleys, you'll find that the vagina is called the Vajorjo.
The Vajorjo?
The Vajorjo. I have a friend who's...
I've heard of Vajiji.
Who said that somebody came to talk to her the other day and they said that they were having problems with their Vajorjo. It's lovely, isn't it? My Vajorjo. It's quite affectionate.
Sounds like a horse, doesn't it?
But moving swiftly on from Vajorjo's, I just have to talk to you about a major thing that's happening on Friday, the 29th of April, everybody.
Oh, yes. My show at the Royal Albert Hall.
Your show at the Royal Albert Hall, which a lot of people will be attending
It was a good booking, wasn't it? Sensible booking.
Because if they're not attending your concert, they might be attending the Royal Wedding.
They might be, yeah. And I'd just like to say that I booked the Royal Albert Hall for my concert before Will made the big mistake of popping
in. It's quite selfish of them, isn't it? Look at them. They're laughing at you there, Tim.
Well, no, I'm just worried that no one's gonna go to their wedding.
That's what he's saying there. Tim mentioned it. They are
double booked in his great uncle's hall.
We've got a street party for your concert.
I'm a bit of a fan of the Royal Weddings.
I went to the last Royal Wedding.
Did you?
I did, yes.
Which one was the last one?
I'm calling the last one the Diane Charles one. That's the last big one.
There's been a couple since then, but that was probably the high profile.
Yes,
one,
so I was happy to turn up at that. Mind you, I would also turn up at a royal beheading. not a major one, but one of the
not
minor
Prince
ones.
Prince Charles, because you want
well,
a little...
Well, Tara Farta Timpinton. You know, someone like that. Come on, we'd all go to that. That would be an event.
Tim, what about you? What do you feel about the royal wedding?
I'm trying to feel something about it. I have a sort of overwhelming sense of numbness. No, I love it. Oh, a wedding's fun, you
good.
Know? Something to put on your put on your plates. I've got a plate of the Jubilee. Is that the 50th?
The 25th, the Silver Jubilee.
The Silver Jubilee. I had a plate in my toilet in Melbourne, Australia, with her on it.
In your toilet, actually in the toilet? You weed on it?
No, it was on the wall. Yeah. Why? Do you put plates in your toilet?
Yeah. Only to celebrate the royal wedding. Yeah. And the other thing we do, actually, is we try and write songs about the royal wedding. And I have started one. And I was just thinking, because you're such a genius when it comes to songwriting, as we've seen tonight, I was wondering if you would help me. See, I can do the first lines, but I can't do the rhyme. Okay. So I thought if we kind of went down a little bit of a blues road and then I'll sing you a line and maybe you could come back with a rhyme for me. We'll see how we get on.
Well, I'm, okay.
Is that okay?
Yeah.
Brilliant. Can my lovely house band give me some music? Okay. Oh, April the 29th is a very special day.
It's 4 weeks after March and 2 days before May.
Put up the bunting and get out the beer.
Bunting is awesome and beer helps you stave off the misery.
I can't wait to see what Katie will wear.
I'm willing to wager she'll dress as a bear.
Everyone will rejoice when the lovebirds get wed.
What, wed?
Wed.
Unless Will calls it off and comes to my show instead.
And we get to holidays, oh, what a piece of luck.
You lie in bed and watch TV and films.
Excellent.
Well, I have had a wonderful time tonight. Thank you to the Rockabellas and my lovely band. A huge thank you to my amazing guests, the delectable Dawn French, the magnificent Michael Sheen, and the truly remarkable Tim Minchin. And of course, a huge thank you to you all for watching. And to play us out tonight, I saw her live in Cardiff only last month with her new single, The Sheep.
So good to begin with, didn't we? But now it seems those shields and swords are haunting me.
Every single room in a